But quality extended life is very important. Otherwise, he's also suffering there. We want to take away the pain and reduce the pain as much as possible. In 1985, I brought the first placenta to the world from Switzerland. And why I brought placenta capsules to the world is because...
Now for the open forum and question and answer portion, may I call back on their screens Dr. Mike Chan, Dr. Nuris Lampe, and of course Dr. Christine Miller. My first question is to Dr. Chan. Good afternoon, Professor Chan. Have you heard of oral stem cell supplements from deers, and can you comment on its effectivity if you've had? Thank you.
Wonderful question. Now, in 1985, I brought the first placenta to the world from Switzerland. And why I brought placenta capsules to the world is because when I was in Hong Kong and Taiwan, I was seeing a lot of packaging. They say made in Switzerland, made in Germany, you know, and made in France. I come to realize when I go to Switzerland and France later on, there's no such company. They are made in Taiwan, made in China, and made in Hong Kong. So I was telling myself, why don't you bring something which is really made in Switzerland? And that's how I produced placenta and brought to the world, and today we're selling to 80 countries. Now, these are placenta extracts in a capsules. The same things go for the deer, okay? The good part is for our sheep, there has to be SPF animals. That is important. I'm very familiar with the deer, but you have to understand, deer is a wild animal. Deer is not the animal where you have in the lab. You don't keep the deer in the lab, all right? So that is something we have to do. Now, there is no stem cells in any capsules. You only have the peptides in the capsule because it will not survive. The cells cannot be in the capsules. There's no such thing as stem cells in the capsules, but you do have the nutrients of a placenta extracts in the capsules. So the question now will be, you have to use the right placenta. Again, in the case of treatment of cancer, you cannot use placenta because placenta will stimulate the cells. Then the cancer patient will have more problem coming in, all right? So you have to select the decision of how to use placenta capsules. Placenta for hormonal balancing, yes, it'll be good. For hormones problem, okay? For wound healing, it's been wonderful for wound healing. So that is my answer. There is no stem cells in capsules. Yeah.
Thank you very much. That question came from Dr. Marites Ayon. Speaking of cancer, from Dr. Tess Badillo, good afternoon, very interesting topic. Will stem cell be an alternative for cancer patients rather than chemotherapy?
Now, again, you have to be careful. Having practiced 35 years with the Swiss clinic and German clinic, in Paracelsus, we have 450 patients a day. Doctors are very full, they're 100 over staff there. And as the owner of Paracelsus for many years, until 2 years ago, I sold it to the Chinese government, Beijing Hospital. So my understanding with biological medicine is yes, there are other treatments, the holistic way to treat cancer patients. Okay, what is cancer? Cancer is a problem with the immune system. You have to detox, you have to take away the heavy metals. Most of the cancer are heavy metals problem. There are gut problem too, which is the second brain, you know, and help solve the problem with the immune. Eradicate all these toxins. Then you move with the repair. Go with the hypothermia, which is wonderful. You need the hyperbaric because you have to feed back the cells to the brain and the body. And you have to have the ozones, and you have the GC-MEF. You have the B17 in Germany, although it's not approved in different countries, many countries in Asia. There's so many other holistic ways. Of course, you still have the thymus. Okay, the thymus is wonderful. There's been a lot of publication in the Soviet Union and Europe, even in Germany, okay, on super transfer factors. Use refrigerated super transfer factors, which comes from the bone marrow. And all cancer patients, you cannot use stem cells openly. You have to use the right stem cells. What are the right stem cells for cancer patients? You need the spleen, okay? You need the thymus. The thymus work together with the spleen, therefore the immune system. You need a small amount of mesenchymal cells. You cannot use placenta. That is very risky. Although there are some cell therapies that have been using it, but I will not take any risk. I will always say, go the holistic way, don't take any risk. Again, even with chemo, you can reduce the dose and go along with this. What happened to the cancer patient? It's going down. The immune system is shooting down. And more so after the chemo, it shoots right down. So what you do is before the chemo, you use the thymus and the super transfer factors, boost up the immune system, it goes up a bit. And when you go for the chemo, it don't shoot right down, it shoots this way. So when you compare the angles before, during, and after the chemo, you continue with your therapy, apart from the chemo, the patients will have quality extended life. Okay, I cannot guarantee every patient will survive, but quality extended life is very important. Otherwise, he's also suffering there. We want to take away the pain and reduce the pain as much as possible. That is how we have been treating in Europe.
Great. Today. Thank you very much, Dr. Chan. Now, if you notice, Dr. Lampy isn't available at the moment, so filling in would be Dr. Sanya Sofra. Dr. Sanya, I've seen the pictures of Dr. Lampy's lecture a while ago, and the results for diabetes is really, really amazing. My question is, do the patients have any specific preparation prior to the treatment that she was mentioning?
No, there is not. It's a technology. It's the new technology that I was using for the acne. It's called Eye Repair, and there's no preparation. There's nothing. She just uses this technology. She has a lot of diabetic patients. She cannot be here today. She had some COVID-19 cases in Aruba.
It's understandable. Well, I'm glad you're here to fill in.
Yes.
So the treatment could be done at any portion of...
It can be done anywhere.
Whether it's discovered earlier or on the latter part?
That's right, yeah. She has a lot of these patients and they come to her with very, very severe... I have seen a lot of... we do not have release to kind of release the pictures, but I have seen the pictures that she has treated. People that they were supposed to go and have amputation, and there was significant healing. I also want to say I was very impressed with Dr. Miller's lecture. Very, very interesting. I'm very impressed with you.
Thank you, Sonia.
Very interesting, Dr. Miller. And as a matter of fact, I have some questions for you as well from Dr. Tess Badillo. Have you heard of any anti-aging supplement that has been discovered for gene expression for aging and targeting aging at the cellular level?
Well, there's some current research, really interesting data. It's not conclusive at this point, but they're looking at the sestrin protein activity. So we'll see where that holds, but that might have some really good applications clinically in the future. Otherwise, we're really looking at, you know, it's customized based on the findings of the patient upon testing. And then, you know, we have calorie restriction and CR mimetics that we can add on board. But hot area of research. There's going to be a lot of data in the next year or two on that.
It's great. You've been mentioning about probiotics and gut health and really part of maintenance. In maintaining gut health, any comments on the use of lactobacillus, and do you recommend the regular use of probiotics?
Yes, lactobacillus is one of the genus that we look at in a probiotic, and in particular, especially with COVID, the strain in particular that they're looking at is lactobacillus rhamnosus GG. Because they found that patients who were on that particular probiotic, if someone in their household was COVID positive, symptomatic or not, no one got COVID. No one tested positive for COVID. So they're really expanding that research at this point. So that's exciting. But you know what I look for in a probiotic, again, it depends on testing. In many cases, I do like to do the full gut testing, But you know, you're looking for diversity. You're looking for diversity in the at least three different genus, and I look for about 10 species if I'm just recommending one, and you know, as a general recommendation. And you know, our food supply quality has changed over the years. And it depends too if we're in an urban environment versus a rural environment. With our, and our gut microbiome can change drastically and very quickly, and sometimes take a while to recover. So oftentimes a probiotic, a balanced probiotic, is a part of good health.
Well, I have another question from Dr. April Vallier. With regard to gut microbiome, are there any studies that supports the use of probiotics in infants where it alters the disease course for chronic inflammatory dermatosis? And aside from probiotics, are there any other supplements that supports gut health?
Well, I don't have a lot of experience when it comes to infants, so I can't really speak directly to that question. In terms of other ways to improve gut health, again, it has to do with the nutrients that we take in. It has to do with the full gut analysis. It's really important to know what our N-butyrate levels are. That's very, very important for the health of that mucosal lining. And so that can tell you a lot. And that also can tell you a lot in terms of the degree of inflammation. And if we may be having some issues with then persistent trigger with the immune triggers related to gut imbalance.
I guess I have a last question. You mentioned a while ago that patients come to you because they already have problems. I actually do DNA profiling, and I see the benefit of it really dealing with the individuality of the patients. My question is, how often would you test for inflammation in general to patients who are relatively essentially well, where they don't really complain much of anything?
You know, I have to say, as a rule, I always test for inflammatory markers, because it's the subclinical smoldering inflammation that can go on for quite some time before symptoms develop. And so it's really important that we catch that, because that's such an important factor in terms of our aging. And we want to, again, we want to slow the aging process. We at least want to age with health and not with pathology.
Exactly. That's all we really want to do. Age really, really gracefully and really slow down the aging process. In the course of time, if you still have other questions for our delegates, you can type it in the chat box and we'll send it to the secretariat so that we can send it to the specific lecturers if you still do have a lot more questions. And I'd like to take this time to present the certificates to our lecturers. May I just read? The Philippine Academy of Aesthetic and Age Management Medicine Incorporated Certificate of Recognition. The certificate is proudly awarded to Professor Dato Sri Dr. Mike Chan in grateful recognition and commendation for sharing his expertise and invaluable knowledge as resource speaker on the topic entitled Stem Cells, Peptides, Exosomes, and Autoimmune Therapy, Why Some Work and Some Don't for COVID-19, Chronic Untreatable Diseases, and Autoimmune Disorders. The same likewise to Dr. Nuris Lampi, in grateful recognition and commendation for sharing her expertise and invaluable knowledge as resource speaker on the topic entitled Technological Advances in Accelerated Wound Repair, Facial Regeneration, and Neuropathic Pain. And of course, last but definitely not least, to Dr. Christine Miller, in grateful recognition and commendation for sharing her expertise and invaluable knowledge as resource speaker on the topic entitled Addressing Chronic Inflammation, A Key to Optimal Health. Given this 30th day of November in the year of our Lord 2020, during the PAAAMMI 8th Annual Convention and First Virtual Convention. Signed, Chairman of the Scientific Committee of the 8th Annual Convention and First Virtual Convention, Dr. Gisela Trajano Sarmiento. Signed by the overall Chairman, Dr. Richard Nicomedes Sarmiento, the Executive Secretary, Dr. Maria Ellery Mendez, and of course, our National President, Dr. Charlie Mendez. Thank you so much. We've learned a lot about gracefully aging, and it was really a very interesting topic. I do hope to see you as we go along and continue the convention. So I guess that's it for the second session.